Let's go this morning to Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter 18. Now, we are going to be continuing in a series we've been doing about the parables of Jesus. Now, if you aren't familiar, Jesus in his earthly ministry, which only lasted for a few years, Jesus in his earthly ministry, many times when he would preach and teach, Jesus would use a literary device called a parable. And what a parable is, it's a very short story. It's not necessarily a true story. It could be fiction, but it represents something that the people at that time would have understood, but it also is meant to convey a much deeper spiritual meaning. Now, some of these parables that Jesus has used up until this point where we're going to be today in Luke chapter 18, some of the parables that he's used have all related to the kingdom of God. See, Jesus did not come on this earth to be an earthly king, to set up an earthly kingdom. He came the first time to set up the heavenly kingdom and to establish the church. Amen? Jesus used these parables to talk about what the kingdom of God looks like. And the first parable that we went through in Matthew chapter 13 just a few weeks ago was the parable of the sower. Jesus said when the word of God goes out into the world, it's like a man who sows seed. And he talked about the different types of soil that the seed could fall on. There are some seeds that sprout up, but then they get tangled up and they die. There are some seeds that look like they're growing, but the sun is too hot and it burns them out. And Jesus said that's a picture of what happens to some people when they hear the word of God. But he talked about the good soil, and he said that there are some people that hear the word of God, and that seed puts roots down deep into the soil of our hearts, and that it springs up and we are new as Christians. Some of us in this room can testify to that. Amen. That seed has gone down deep and we are now believers in Jesus Christ because of the word of God alive in us. Jesus used another parable. He said the kingdom of God is like a field of wheat, and that a thief or a criminal came in and sowed weeds among the wheat. And Jesus told us that that is Satan. And that's a picture of what happens when sin enters into the world and into the church. Sin is in the world, isn't it? We see it every day in the news, don't we? We see it on the headlines, on social media. Sin has entered the world and church. We also know that sin is growing up in the church too, don't we? If you came in this morning expecting a perfect church, you went to the wrong one. Amen? There's sin in here. There's sinners in here. This is a real place for real people. You say, man, I'm screwed up. I don't know if I belong here. Trust me, you belong. You belong. Jesus used another parable. And this very, very short parable that Jesus used, and we preached on this just a couple weeks ago, it's the parable of the treasure hidden in a field. And Jesus, in this parable in Matthew 13, said that a man was walking in a field, and he stumbled upon a treasure buried in the ground. And the Bible says in Matthew 13 that in his joy, the man looked at this treasure, and he went and he sold everything he had to get the money so that he could buy the field that the treasure was buried in. And Jesus says that's a picture of the kingdom of God. And he is illustrating the point as we get ready to go into some real world scenarios that Jesus dealt with. Jesus is illustrating the point that finding Jesus and becoming a Christian and being saved is just like minding your own business. You hear the word of God, and in the word of God, in the gospel of Jesus, you find it to be so valuable and to be such a treasure that anything you got to give up in order to get it, you give up in order to get it. Amen, church? Whatever we got to lay down, Jesus says, you lay it down. Whatever you got to give up to get the treasure, Jesus says, you give that up. That's what the kingdom of God is like. Jesus has already painted a picture for us that being a Christian will cost you something. Amen? The treasure is free. The gift of God is free, but there are things in our life we got to be willing to give up if we're going to go and take it. Amen? Jesus has given us this illustration as we get into the book of Luke. As we get into the book of Luke. Luke chapter 18, starting in verse 9. It says, he, talking about Jesus, also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. I think the church can hear this morning. Amen? It says, he told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Now, church, keep in mind, Pharisees in that day were like the religious leaders. They were like the mega church pastors. They're the ones everybody looked to. They had everything right on the outside. And tax collectors were about the opposite. Who in here is very familiar with income tax. You get your paycheck and it's supposed to be like 100% and it ends up being like 60%. That stinks, doesn't it? I remember when I got my first real job and I knew what my check was going to be and I got it in a direct deposit and I looked and the amount was about 60% of what I expected. I learned a very valuable lesson that day. The government will take your money and give it to somebody else. That's called tax, okay? In this day that Jesus is speaking, there was no income tax that automatically came out of the check. You got the whole check, which none of us know what that feels like. You get 100%, and then by Tuesday or Wednesday, there's a knock on the door. It's the tax collector. Hey, Dave, I heard you made some money this week. I'm here to see you. How much money did you make this week? Oh, you made 50 bucks. Good for you. The tax is 30. Dave says, well, wait a minute. Last week, it was only 15. He says, well, today it's 30. You want to go to jail? You want to pay up? Dave pays up. People didn't like the tax collectors. Amen. They were jerks. Nobody liked them. This is the picture Jesus is using. You got a Pharisee, got everything right on the outside. You got the tax collector. He's a mess. Nobody likes him. And they stand here in the temple, it says, to pray. It says the Pharisee in verse 11, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men. Church, if your prayer starts like that, you're missing something. Amen. I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes up to heaven, but he beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. In verse 14, Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Point number one, God is the source and the subject of our justification. Now you may say, what in the world is justification? Justification is a big Bible word that literally means this. Those who are saved are justified before God. And what that means is that we are viewed by God to be innocent and just. Amen? If you're a Christian, God looks at you not as the sinner that you are, but as the righteousness and the perfection that Jesus was. Can I get an amen, church? It's called double imputation. It's a big theological phrase that literally means this. We are sinners, just like the tax collector. We stink just like the tax collector. Yet Jesus, in his perfection, came to save people just like me and you and the tax collector. Amen? Therefore, when we give our lives to Jesus, when we humble ourselves and get saved, our sin gets transferred to Jesus on the cross. He takes the punishment. He takes the blame. And his perfection, his righteousness gets transferred to us. And when we stand before God, both today and in the judgment when we die, the Bible tells us that God will look upon those who are justified as innocent, just like Jesus. Amen? That's literally what it means to be saved. So we can learn from this parable that the Pharisee who had everything right on the outside didn't get saved. The tax collector who had everything wrong on the outside, yet on the inside knew that he needed the mercy of God. The Bible says he got saved. Amen? Now remember, parables are meant to teach a truth that we are to relate to. So whenever God gives us two people, the question we need to then ask ourselves, church, is which person am I, correct? We need to ask, am I the Pharisee or am I the tax collector? Now, the Pharisee prayed a very self-righteous, self-centered prayer. Amen? Y'all see that in the scripture? It looks like he was gathering attention for himself. But if you look at verses 11 and 12, what you find is the Pharisee was actually standing by himself. He wasn't necessarily in public in front of a bunch of people. He was standing by himself, and he was praying a prayer that I think the church in America could probably relate to. He said, God, thank you. He gave God the credit. So God was the source of his justification. He said, God, thank you that I'm not like all of these other people. And we Christians hear that and go, man, what a loser. What a jerk. He's messed it. He's got it all wrong. And yet, church, isn't the perception of us from the world that we look down on everybody else thinking, God, that we're not just like them? Thank you, God, that I'm not like homosexuals. Thank you, God, that I'm not like this race of people, or that race of people, or this group of people, or that group of people. Thank you, God, that you have made me different and better than everybody else. And you say, man, I would never, ever pray like that. I would never say that out loud. But church, How guilty are we often in our hearts? And that's where Jesus is looking, amen, is to the heart. How guilty are we to look at other people and say, God, thank you that you didn't make me just like them. Thank you that you kept me from being that type of person in church. We were just like them. We are just like them, save for one thing, and that's the mercy and grace of Jesus that saves us in our sin. Amen? The Pharisee prayed a prayer that says, God, thank you that you didn't make me like these other people. And the Bible says that he did not receive salvation and justification in Jesus Christ. The tax collector, who was a dirty sinner, he was looked down upon by everybody in society and by the church, said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus says he went home justified. So church, the goal should be that we get here, correct? The goal should be that we find what the tax collector had, and we have that attitude, not the attitude of the Pharisee, amen? Let's look at something and see it. Let's look at the difference here. The Pharisee looked down at himself, or down at others rather, and up at himself. The tax collector looked down at himself and looked up at God. Listen, church. In order to be saved and justified, God must be not only the source of what makes you good, he is the subject and the fulfillment of all that's good in you. Amen? It ain't about our goodness at all. You may come into this place this morning and say, you know what? I got things together pretty well. I live a pretty good life. And that's a great thing for you and happy for you. But if that's what defines your faith in Jesus Christ needs to become the subject of your faith, not yourself. Amen? See, here's the danger. When we become the standard for everyone else, like the Pharisee was, and we say, listen, God has saved me, and this is the type of life that I live, and we become the standard for everybody else, we immediately begin to compare ourselves to everybody else, and we immediately begin to look down on everybody else. Amen? When I'm the standard, I start worrying about what everybody else is doing. Well, I tithe, but these people here aren't tithing. What's wrong with them? Well, I pray three times a day. I fast weekly, and yet these guys over here, they never fast. What's wrong with them? See, when I become the standard of goodness, nobody's got it figured out but me, and I judge everybody else because of it. Amen? There's a danger, church, of putting ourselves in the place of God and being the standard of righteousness. We were never called to be that. When you put your focus on yourself and who you are and what you do, everybody else becomes a failure around you, and you live your life kind of judgy, and it's really hard to reach people when you're not at their level. Amen? When we adopt the mentality of the tax collector and we recognize the depth and depravity of our own sin before a holy God, all of a sudden we're not looking down at anybody except ourselves. Amen? And I pray that those of you in the room today who have given your heart and soul to Jesus Christ, you've prayed the prayer, you've done the baptism, you've done all the outward things. I pray that today, as you hear the parable, as you hear the word of God, and you examine yourself and you say, okay, I need to figure out, am I the Pharisee or am I the tax collector? I pray that as you examine yourself, you don't begin looking at the outward appearance of who you are, but you look at the heart and say, okay, am I proud of me or am I appealing to the mercy of God to save me? Because this is the attitude that gets you where you need to go. Amen? Let's keep going. Now, we're going to make a pretty drastic shift here. Jesus, up to this point, has been teaching in parables. But in verse 15, starting in verse 15, we get a shift into real life. So at this point, Jesus is no longer teaching. Verse 15 says that people, they were bringing even infants to him that he might touch them. Talking about Jesus. And when the disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called to them and said, let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. You see what's happening? So Jesus is teaching, and people are hearing Jesus teach, and they know that he's a man with authority. In fact, in a few verses here, we're going to see a man run up to Jesus and say, hey, good teacher. He's a good teacher, amen? Jesus is teaching things and people are going, yeah, this is right, this is correct. So they're bringing their infants and going, Jesus, would you touch my baby? And the disciples are looking at this and going, wait a minute. The kingdom of God isn't about children. It's about adults. It's about making choices. It's about being responsible. It's about following Jesus. It's about giving things up in order to have things right with Jesus. And babies can't do that. Babies aren't at the point where they can make that decision. And Jesus says, wait a minute, don't hinder children from coming to me. And he uses an example of the infants and says, this is the attitude you must adopt if you're to enter the kingdom of God. I want to introduce y'all real quick. This is my wife, and she's bringing up my daughter. She's my youngest. I'm getting a smile there. Hi, baby. This is Andy. Andy's 4 months old, and I love her with all my heart, and y'all can probably see why. Amen. She's pretty perfect. But the reality is about Andy, she doesn't do a lot to help out around the house. Amen. She's a little lazy. She sleeps a lot. She can be pretty whiny. When she needs something, she can't communicate it that well. She just cries. She cries. And pretty much my interaction with my daughter, you get the occasional smile, get the occasional laugh, but most of our lives with our daughter is literally spent just carrying her around because she can't walk on her own, she can't do anything for herself. When she's hungry, she cries. When she's uncomfortable, she cries. When she's lonely, she cries. When she's bored, she cries. When her diaper needs to be changed, she cries. This is the life we live with my daughter, and pretty much all she offers to us are dirty diapers. That's the only thing she gives back, dirty diapers. We feed her, pay all the money, we get dirty diapers in return. Now listen, most of us, maybe today, maybe in the past, maybe this is where you are right this moment, we look at Jesus and we look at the church and we look at the Bible, and then we look at ourselves and we say, man, I'm a mess, amen? I'm desperate. I need what Jesus offers. And the first thing we tend to do is we try to begin cleaning ourselves up and getting ourselves right to receive Jesus. You ever had this conversation? Let me give you an example. And I've used this example many times, but I believe it's so telling of our nature. You see somebody out there and you begin to talk to somebody about maybe being a Christian, or you invite them to the church, and they immediately start saying, well, here's all the good things I do. You know, I try to be a good person. You know, I try to treat people well. I try to treat people with respect. And maybe you meet somebody who used to go to church and they no longer do. And they say, oh, yeah, I need to get back in church. I really need to get back reading my Bible again. I need to get back doing my daily devotional. I need to get back to church. I need to start serving. I need to start doing this and start doing that. Y'all ever had this conversation? Every time you talk to somebody about coming to church or becoming a Christian, this is the conversation you have. And I think this is the tendency of most of us, because I think our natural tendency is to become a Pharisee, isn't it? We clean ourselves up, then we say, look at me, God, thank you so much. I'm not like all those other people out there. And yet Jesus says, if you want to enter the kingdom, this should be your attitude. The relationship we have with Jesus in our natural state is not one. Here, if you want to take her back. She pukes quite a bit, so we're on the clock right now, trying to avoid that. Jesus says, the state at which you enter the kingdom, the line of thinking you've got to have to come to Jesus and to be made right with God, the attitude that you have to bring to the table is not one who's trying to make yourself better, but it's one who comes like an infant with nothing to offer. Amen? That's the attitude we bring to Jesus. Point number two. Justification requires only two things. Number one is dirty diapers. Number two is desperation. That's the title of my sermon today. It's dirty diapers and desperation. It's a metaphor for the life that I live every day and have lived for several years now, but it's also what Jesus wants from us. You say, what in the world does that mean, church? I believe what it means is what the tax collector exhibited for us, amen, in the scripture. The tax collector brought nothing of value. The Pharisee says, look at all that I've done well, God, thank you so much. The tax collector said, there's nothing good, I need the mercy of God, amen. He brought his dirty diapers to the cross. How many of you in this life this morning have lived in a place in your life where your diaper was dirty? Not physically, don't tell me, I don't want to know, okay? If your diaper's dirty this morning, go get that taken care of, okay? Nobody's going to judge you. But I'm talking about spiritually. Spiritually, we have a tendency to screw things up, don't we? My goodness, some of us in this room have been wearing a dirty diaper for way too long spiritually, and I know that's kind of a funny, jokey metaphor, but seriously, if you wait to try and clean yourself up before you come to God, you're going to go into eternity not knowing Him, because you're going to keep going home the same as you came in, dirty and unjustified. Jesus says if you're going to enter the kingdom, you bring your mess with you. Jesus is looking for your mess. Jesus is looking for you to be desperate. If you're in this place this morning and you say, Pastor, I love the way this sounds. I love the idea that Jesus loves me, but I just don't think you know where I've been and what I've done. You may be in this place this morning and you've kind of got the Pharisee thing going on where on the outside you've got it right, but on the inside there is a struggle that nobody's aware of. Maybe it's pornography. Maybe it's some type of addiction. Maybe it's some type of anger or hatred in your life that you hide because you know it's unbecoming for a Christian. You say, Pastor, if anybody knew what's down deep inside of me, neither Jesus nor the church would accept me. Maybe you're the tax collector and you say, listen, my reputation is horrible. Everybody knows who I am. Everybody knows what I've done. Everybody knows what I've screwed up. The church would never accept me. Jesus doesn't want me. Church, for both of us, either side of the argument, what Jesus is saying in this parable is, don't try to clean yourself up because you can't. Humans are not the standard. The only standard that God accepts is that of Jesus Christ. And the only way you get there is if you bring your dirty diapers and your desperation to the foot of the cross and say, Jesus, have mercy on me, a sinner. That's what Jesus is asking for. Amen. That is the state of the heart that Jesus wants. You say, you don't know what kind of mess I am. And I say, Jesus knows and he still wants you. That's the amazing thing about Christianity that is so unique from every religion and thought pattern and way of thinking in this world is that Jesus sees us as we are and he doesn't leave us there. He loves us so much, John 3:16, that God sent him to this world so that he could save us, so that whosoever would believe in him wouldn't have to perish but can have everlasting life. Amen? Jesus wants us, dirty diapers, desperation, mess and all. Don't put it off as this young man does that we're about to read about. Verse 18. Now keep in mind, we're not talking parables anymore. We're talking real life. This actually happened. Verse 18. Jesus had just got done teaching the kingdom of heaven like a sower who throws out seed. The seed goes down. Some people get it. Some people don't. Jesus had just got through teaching that there's going to be people, the wheat and the weeds, they look just alike, they grow up together, you can't tell them apart, but one day they're going to be separated and judged, and only those who truly have it right with Jesus are going to enter into eternal life. Jesus had just got through teaching that the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that we find, and in our joy, we sell all we have so that we can get what we have and what we find in that treasure. And then Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven, it's like a Pharisee and a tax collector. The Pharisee trusted in his own good works. The tax collector trusted in the mercy of God. Tax collector went home justified. Jesus just taught this. And we have a young man in verse 18. It says, a ruler asked him, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother. And the tax, and not the tax collector, the young ruler said in verse 21, all these I have kept from my youth. And my goodness, this sounds like the church today, doesn't it? Jesus tells us what we need. We can clearly see in the Bible what God asks of us. Amen? I'm convinced as a pastor, now more than ever in my life, the only thing keeping us from the true word of God and us understanding it are our priorities. You've got it on your phone, you got it on your tablet, you got it on your computer, you got it on your bookshelf. There it is. We can read it black and white, plain as day. The words of Jesus are even in red, so you can see them clearly. What Jesus asks of us is clear, amen? This rich young ruler, he had money, he had a good reputation, and he seemed to be a pretty moral guy. And he comes to Jesus and said, hey, Jesus, you're a good teacher. Tell me what I'm lacking. Tell me what I need to do to inherit eternal life. Tell me what I need to do to be justified. Tell me what I need to do to be saved. And Jesus says, hey, keep live a moral life. Keep the commandments. You know what the commandments are. And the rich young ruler said what I think so many people in the church today, if they faced Jesus, would say. He said, I've always done these things. I'm a good guy. Matthew chapter 7, we learn that there's the day of judgment coming when there are going to be people who are going to face the God of the universe and they're going to say, Jesus, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out demons? Didn't we preach in your name? And Jesus is going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. It's a scary truth, but it's coming. And we must not be among those who are deceived, just as the Pharisee was, looking at the outward expression of righteousness while completely missing the point of the gospel on the inside. The rich young ruler comes to Jesus with everything right on the outside, yet he was missing something on the inside. Can I get an amen, church? The rich young ruler comes to Jesus having done everything the Bible had told him to do, and yet he was empty. Now, I would ask you, why would a person with money, status, political power, a good reputation, and a moral life need anything else from Jesus? Can I offer a simple explanation that all of the outward expressions of goodness that this world offers are empty and will leave you hopeless and wanting more? We know it's true because we see it in the Bible, yet we often live as the rich young ruler or as the Pharisee, making sure we look the part and telling Jesus how great everything is, but on the inside, week after week, coming into a church, hearing the word of God and going, man, I'm missing something. Can anybody identify with that? Man. I've been in church so many times as a kid and as a teenager, I couldn't count them. I grew up, and my mom's here today, and she could testify, just in case you think I'm making this up. As a kid and as a teenager, I wasn't involved in premarital sexual activity. I didn't drink. I didn't smoke. I didn't do drugs. I didn't hang out with bad people. I was pretty much the kid everybody would have wanted. I was in church my whole childhood, and as a teenager, I played music in the worship band, and that's pretty much what I spent my summers doing, is playing music with good Christian people. When I went off to college, I lived in an apartment complex with three other people, all of whom now today are ministers of the gospel in some way. I was around the right people. I looked like the right person. I knew a lot of the Bible. I could quote verses for you, but on the inside, I was as dead as the Pharisee who prayed that prayer in the temple. Amen. I was missing something. I was missing something. And maybe you're here today and you can identify with that. Maybe you're a Christian now and you say, yes, Pastor, I've been there. I want you to pray for the people around you, because the deception that Satan would give to people to say, listen, you're fine. Just keep doing the right things. Keep the commandments. Do everything right. If you'll just keep looking the part, eventually you'll feel the part and things will be fine. It's a lie, isn't it, church? That longing in your heart for the righteousness of Jesus that you just can't quite get to never goes away. And until you submit to Jesus like a child, desperate and dirty, you'll never get there. Look what happens to the rich young ruler. He said, all these things I've kept from my youth. And when Jesus heard this, he said to him, one thing you still lack. Sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Jesus did something miraculous here. Now, don't get tripped up over this. Being a Christian doesn't mean that you got to sell everything you have. Amen? Being a Christian doesn't mean you got to sell everything you have. But what Jesus was doing here is what Jesus often did. He was cutting through all the bull and looking right at the guy's heart. This young man came to Jesus and said, Jesus, I've done everything right, yet something in my life is missing, and I just can't quite put my finger on it. Jesus, you're a good teacher. Can you tell me the one thing I'm missing? Jesus looked into his heart and said, you love your possessions too much. Sell them. Come follow me. And don't you think that Jesus had the parable of the treasure hidden in the field in mind when he said it? Don't you think that Jesus had just taught this and was thinking, I have just illustrated this in a parable. The parable says that the kingdom of God is like a treasure buried in a field. And when a man finds it, he looks at it and in his joy sells all that he has to get the treasure. And here we have a young man saying, Jesus, I'm missing something. You seem to have answers. Can you give me the answer to what I'm missing? And what Jesus tells him is, what you're missing is that you won't give yourself up to get me. Go sell all you have, give it to the poor, and then come follow me. You'll have eternal life. Look what happens. This is a terrifying story. When he heard these things, verse 23 says, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. See, this rich young ruler looked at Jesus, and he looked at what Jesus was going to cost him. And he looked back at all the things that he had accomplished. And faced with the dilemma, Will I make this exchange? He looked at the stuff in the world and he said, I just can't let go of what's out there for me. I just can't. And he became very sad and he walked away from it. And all indications are scripturally that this man went into eternity not knowing the mercy and the grace of Jesus Christ. I don't know that to be true, but there's no indications that this young man ever repented of this. And Jesus says in response, he said, how difficult is it for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God? For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And those who heard it said, then who can be saved? I mean, at this point, think about it. If you're one of the disciples, you're following Jesus, or you're one of these people here listening to this sermon, you go, okay, the Pharisee can't get it right, and the Pharisee has been trained up in the Bible from the time he was a kid. He's never screwed up publicly. I've never seen this guy get it wrong, and yet Jesus says this guy's not a Christian. Then Jesus says, hey, this rich young ruler that's kept all the commandments, he's not a Christian either. He's going away sad, unjustified in the kingdom of God. And the disciples, everybody are going, oh my goodness, how then do we get saved? And Jesus says something that we can all quote in verse 27. He says, What is impossible with man is possible with God. Amen? There are people in the room today that have heard this story a million times and it's never once shaken their heart. And for me to foolishly think that I could get up and speak the same thing for the millionth and one time and that it would make a difference is foolishness. Amen? Hear the same thing over and over, no results. What's one more time going to do? There are those of you in this room who are Christians and you've got people in your life and you have witnessed to them and asked them to come to church and told them the gospel over and over and over and it just looks impossible. How are we going to get this person on their knees before God to recognize their own sinfulness? And church, here's something we got to get back to. We begin to pray believing that what is impossible with man is possible with God. Amen? What is impossible with man is possible with God. There is nothing outside the reach of God's power. Verse 28, Peter, who often spoke up, he said, see, we've left our homes and followed you. And look at what Jesus says here in verse 29. He says, truly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not receive many times more in this time and in the age to come. Church, point number three, what you give up temporarily, you get back eternally. Amen? Jesus illustrates this parable with a true story of a rich young ruler who counted the cost and said, nope, I don't want Jesus. Church, what I ask you today is to take some stock of your life. Take some stock of your own heart. Look at yourself objectively. Look at your heart spiritually to the very best of your ability. Understand, church, that Jesus will cost us something. Amen? Any church, any pastor that'll tell you that you can just live a good moral life and you can just add Jesus on top of that to put the icing on the cake and make everything perfect, they're lying to you. Church, Jesus will cost you something, but Jesus gives us a principle here that, church, we have got to remember and we have got to believe for ourselves and we've got to bury this down deep in our souls because, church, the storms of this life are coming and we are going to lose things. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure you find hidden in a field, and some of you this morning, maybe for the first time, maybe for the thousandth time, are facing this treasure once again and you're looking at it and you're saying, and I didn't expect to find this here today, but yet here it is, staring you in the face. You've got an opportunity. What are you going to do with it? You got to count the cost. You know what this thing is going to cost you. If we are going to come into the kingdom, if we are going to be justified before a holy, righteous, sinless God, if we are going to be called innocent in the sight of God, we have got to be willing to lay our pride and our material things down if necessary to do that. Amen? If this is going to define us, we've got to be willing to bring our dirty diapers and our desperation and lay our pride down and give it to Jesus. And some of you, maybe for the thousandth time in your life, are looking at the opportunity to become a Christian and you're counting the cost and you're going, man, if Jesus and the church just knew what I'm packing into this place with me, they wouldn't want me here. And church, it'll cost you something to follow Jesus. Sinner, it will cost you your pride to follow Jesus. You got to enter the kingdom like a child. It'll cost you something to follow Jesus. Maybe it's your pride. Maybe you've got sins buried down deep in your life that nobody knows about. And you think, man, if that comes out into the open, if I confess that to God, it will ruin my reputation. And what I think Jesus would say to our reputation is just how valuable is your reputation compared to the treasure that is the mercy and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. Count the cost. Just how valuable is it to keep your reputation but being dead on the inside? You come to this place this morning maybe saying, I've got it all good, but I'm missing something. And what Jesus is saying is the thing that you're missing is taking that secret thing, confessing it, and following Jesus in humility and in brokenness and in desperation. But you've got to decide whether or not it's worth it. In church, what Jesus tells us here in the scripture is that it's worth it both now and forever. He says, truly, I say to you, there is nobody who's left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not receive many times more in this time and in the age to come eternal life. You say, well, if I follow Jesus, I might lose this relationship. Then lose it. What you'll get back's better. If I follow Jesus, these people in my life will disown me. Then be homeless. Better to be homeless in the kingdom of God than to be rich in the kingdom of this world and to go into this place unjustified in the presence of God. You say, well, I may lose some of this stuff if I give my life to Jesus. Then lose it. You're not happy anyway. Jesus tells us whatever we got to give up, we give up. And yet we come to church in America that tells us that we can have our cake and eat it too. You can have the best of both kingdoms, and you just can't. You just can't. Being a Christian is going to cost you something, but the only type of church that's going to impact this community, the only type of faith that's going to impact your family, the only type of Christianity that's going to turn this world around, lost in its sin and its hopelessness, is a Christianity that finds its joy in the treasure of Jesus Christ alone. No divided allegiances. We got to lay down the things that hold us back from the cross of Jesus Christ. Our pride, our treasures, our sin, our dirty diapers. Bring them to the foot of the cross and believe and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. Be made new by the righteousness of God. Be refreshed and revived by the Holy Spirit. And Jesus says, whatever you give up now, you'll get back tenfold in the age that is now and the age to come. What Jesus is saying is, hey, you're not going to be homeless. You're not going to be desperate when you've got Jesus. Jesus told that woman at the well, when you drink of me, you're never thirsty. What you give up now, you'll get back, both in this world and in the age to come. So church, we got a decision to make, don't we? We got a decision to make. Is it worth it? Is Jesus worth it? And I'm going to ask you all to stand this morning. I'm going to let Luke play right now, and I'm going to do something a little bit different for invitation. I'm not going to ask the band to come up. I'm just going to let Luke continue to play softly, and I'm just going to put this out there. And I've got no expectations. I've got no desire to manipulate anybody. I don't want to put pressure on somebody to make a decision. But this morning, I'm going to simply ask a question. Is there anybody in this room today who wants to come forward right now and say that they are going to believe and accept Jesus as their Savior right now, forsaking whatever they got to forsake to get it? Is there anybody that'll do that today? I don't want to drag an invitation out. We are not going to beg you, but church, I can promise you, when you make the decision to believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior and you're willing to come to Jesus dirty and broken, He will lift you up and exalt you and put you in His kingdom. Your life will be different. Amen? Not saying you'll be rich. Not saying you'll be popular. I'm not promising you anything here on this earth. But what I can promise you is you'll live with the love and acceptance of a holy God. You can go home guiltless and clean before God. You can go home without that pit in your stomach. You can go home and expect that, hey, next time I come to church, I don't have to keep asking myself what's missing. Because there won't be anything missing. The Holy Spirit will be there, filling that empty space. Is there anybody today that would do that this morning and say, Pastor, that's me. I need Jesus right now. If nobody's going to come, then we're going to be dismissed. Father, I thank you this morning for your word, God. And I pray that this morning, if there be anybody in this place who has heard the word, and God, they know they're missing something, God, they know that they don't have you, God, I pray that even though they did not decide to come forward this morning, Father, I pray that you don't quit working on them. Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would convict their hearts. And Father, I pray if necessary, you would wreck their world in order to bring them to the place where they need to accept you as their Lord and Savior. Jesus, thank you for the exchange you made for me. Your righteousness for my sin. My failure for your victory. My hopelessness for your hope. My death for your life. My failure of a kingdom for your kingdom. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your grace and your love. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.